What a girl, what a world, what a life. Oh, I married Joan. What a mind, loving blind, what a wife. He is gay all day, she keeps my heart laughing. Never know where her brain has flown. To each his own. Can't deny that, why I married Joan.
The Joan Davis Show. I Married Joan, America's favorite comedy show, starring America's queen of comedy, Joan Davis, as Mrs. Joan Stevens. And featuring Jim Backus as Judge Bradley Stevens.
Husband's a very young man to be selected for such an important post. But the party figures that his ability as a judge was so outstanding that the voters would pick him over any other candidate. And with Brad running for public office, you'll be expected to help. We expect you to bring in a lot of votes.
Well, how's all this for helping?
Oh, it's fine, Joan, fine, but it's not what I had in mind. You see, Brad is running against Judge Bennington.
Oh, Brad is much more popular than Judge Bennington.
Well, that may be, but voters are influenced by strange things. Now, take Judge Bennington's wife.
I've seen her. She's strange, all right.
Nevertheless, she's an important factor in this election. All their publicity is aimed at showing what a happy home life they've got. It's up to us to fight it.
You mean get them to separate somehow?
No, no. We'll have to fight fire with fire. You and Brad will have to show the voters that you have a happier home life, that you're even closer. That way, we'll get the sentimental votes as well as the regular. Joan, what are you doing?
I'm just trying to see if Brad would look more dignified with a mustache and a beard.
Huh? Oh, Walter. Well, sorry to keep you waiting. I was shaving. I have to look nice for my new campaign manager, you know.
Maybe I'd better shave again.
Joan, what is this, honey?
Just an experiment, dear. I like you better the way you are.
Oh, well, thank you.
Oh, sit down, Walter. Sit down. Tell me, how are things going with the campaign?
Well, I was just telling Joan. Bennington's making a big thing of his happy home life.
Oh, is that
surefire stuff with voters.
Well, we'll match our home life against his any time, won't we?
That's exactly what you're going to have to do. From now on, Joan will be with you whenever you make a speech or meet the press.
Oh, we'll show them how happy we are. Say, I'll need a complete new wardrobe, dear. A suit or two, a pair of shoes.
Joanie, enough of that. Your clothes are plenty good enough.
But, Brad, if you want me to make an impression, why
not? Brad's right, Joan. If you look too well-dressed, the women voters will be envious.
Maybe one dress.
Joanie, let me remind you that I'm the candidate, not you, dear.
Now, the idea is to cover as many districts as we can. In addition to speeches, there will have to be meetings on a more personal basis.
Oh, yes. Let's see. Here's where I kiss the babies and shake hands.
Huh? And don't forget, memorize names. It's a flattering to a voter to be called by name.
Oh, yes. Okay. Now, I'll be prepared to answer any questions about our platform. All right, Joan, you can buy a dress.
Thank you, Brad.
Now, I think that the issues that I raise will be very effective with the voters. All right, honey, you can buy the shoes and the handbag, too. Now, I want to bring home to all the voters my record. The fact that I have... Joanie, I told you to buy a dress, the handbag, the shoes. Why are you still crying?
I'm not crying, Brad. I've just got a cold.
Oh, all right. A cold?
Oh, no.
Well, it's just a little cold. It'll be gone in a couple of days.
But you'll have to get rid of it right away.
Well, that's silly. You just don't say to a cold, go. He won't listen, you know. Silly.
Well, Joanie, don't you understand? You're going to have to face the voters with me. And you look terrible with a cold.
If you're going to help Brad, Joan, you have to look and feel your best.
Well, I'm willing. As a matter of fact, I feel...
Look, dear, you'd better run down to Dr. Smith and get a shot or something. No time to lose, dear.
Okay, Brad, okay.
Oh, this is a catastrophe.
I... A high fever?
No fever at all.
No fever? Must be a cold, cold.
Frankly, Joan, you have no cold at all.
Oh, now, Doctor, you don't have to be afraid to tell me. I must have a cold. I've been sneezing and sniffling all morning.
You're suffering from a hypersensitivity to some substance which is innocuous to others.
Doctor, don't say that. I'm still young. I'm serious, is it?
It isn't serious at all, Joan. You have an allergy, that's all.
An allergy? How can that be? I've never been allergic before.
Allergies can be pretty baffling things, Joan. You may have suddenly developed an allergy to something that you've been in contact with all of your life. I think we'll save time if I give you the regular allergy reaction test.
This isn't going to hurt, is it, Doctor? I don't want you to think I'm a coward, but I am. Doctor!
What's the matter, Joan?
Well, the sneezing. It's gone, and I'm not sniffling anymore. I'm cured. Doctor, you are an absolute genius. Imagine being cured of an allergy in just one visit. Why, I'll tell everyone about your new method. It'll revolutionize medicine.
What new method?
Oh, why, you... And then you gave me... You didn't do anything, did you?
That's right. You still have your allergy.
Well, I feel wonderful.
Well, that's because you're not exposed to whatever you're allergic to. Did you first notice this at home?
Yes, this morning.
Then whatever it is, it's in your house. And I think when you get back, you'll find that it'll start again. I'll come over this evening, John, and we'll make a series of tests.
Well, you'll be wasting your time, Doctor. I never felt better in my life. I'm completely cured.
Look, Joan, I'm a doctor. I should certainly know what I'm talking about. And I have never lost a patient.
This one almost got away.
Oh, hello there.
How
are you?
Fine.
Say, let me look at you. You're all over that cold. That Dr. Smith is a magician.
No, and I just feel great. He said I didn't even have a cold.
Oh, now, wait a minute. I saw you this morning. You not only had a cold, you were next door to pneumonia.
I know, but he said that I was allergic to something. Isn't that ridiculous?
An allergy, eh? Well, maybe you are, Joan.
Oh, don't be silly, Ben. Do I look like I have an allergy to something? Don't I look the picture of health? Don't I...
Joan! Joan, it's back!
Oh, no. My eyes are watering again.
Oh, Joanie, we've got to find what you're allergic to. You can't go through my campaign sniffling and sneezing.
I know, Brad. Oh, sure.
Now, look, dear, let's be very scientific about this. You go over on the sofa and sit down.
Hi, Dad.
How do you feel?
I feel better.
Joni, that's it. It's the flowers.
Oh, Brad, it couldn't be that. I picked him and I put him in the vase. It didn't bother me then, though.
Well, dear, it must be something else, that's all.
Brad?
Yes, dear?
Come here, dear. What's making me sneeze?
You do? What is it?
You. I'm allergic to my own husband.
Oh, no, Joe! Joe! I have never heard of such a thing in my life. A woman allergic to her own husband. I just don't believe it. I absolutely, unconditionally refuse to believe it. That's all. Joan, look, now, I just can't believe it.
I don't believe it either, Brad, but stay away from me.
Oh.
No.
I know this sounds fantastic, Brad, but I'm afraid it's true.
Well, if she has to be allergic, why does she have to be allergic to me? Why can't she be allergic to ragweed, pollen, or goldenrod? Something that normal people are allergic to. Now, Doctor, you said that you've heard of these cases before. What do they do?
It's a terrible thing to contend with. I knew of one case that was so severe that the couple had to actually get a divorce.
Divorce?
Well, Doctor, that's impossible. After all, 10 years of marriage is nothing to sneeze at.
Doctor, what are we going to do?
I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to see that Joan gets some relief. Now, you've got to leave home, oh, temporarily. Check into a hotel.
But I can't leave my wife when she's feeling like this.
Well, if you don't, her condition may grow worse.
Well, Joni,
Oh, you better get out before I blow you up.
Hello? Oh, Joni, lover. How are you? How do you feel?
Awful, Brad. Just awful.
You mean you're still sneezing?
No, I stopped as soon as you left. That's why I feel so terrible. I feel bad because I feel good. That is, I don't really feel good because I feel bad.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
I always knew that absence makes the heart grow fonder. Now I know it's good for the nose, too.
Hold it a second, dear. There's someone at the door.
Well, Brad, this is the fine kettle of fish.
What is?
This. You being here. Bennington's campaign headquarters is circulating a rumor you've left your wife. They were probably tipped off as soon as you checked in here last night and drew their own conclusion.
Well, evidently you did the same thing.
Well, what does this look like?
Well, sure, I've left my wife, but it's only temporary, not because we split up. She's allergic to me.
All right, so she's... What did you say?
I said she's allergic to me. I make her sneeze.
Well, Brad, I don't think this is very nice of you, keeping me waiting like this.
I can see the slogans now. How can the people stand Stevens if his wife can't?
Yeah, I know you're right, but what am I going to do?
You've got to go back home to your wife.
Well, I can't do that. She'd be miserable. I'd rather withdraw from the campaign.
Well, you can't do that either. You'll drag the whole slate down with you. Brad, my boy, this thing's bigger than you. It's bigger than me. Now, you've got to do this for the party. Now, pack and go home back to your wife, even if she does sneeze a little.
A little? Believe me, when I get home, she'll blow her top.
Brad! Brad! Oh, Brad!
Well, it's about time. You've got a nerve keeping me waiting all the time like this.
Joni, I'm right here.
Brad, you're here.
Oh, yeah. Patton came in. I thought I left you on the phone.
Oh, Brad, I'm so happy you're home, dear. I missed you so much.
Well, I've been miserable, too.
Well, what made you come home, dear?
Patton talked me into it. He said it was for the good of the party. Bennington and his crowd are starting a rumor that you and I are going to split up.
Well, of all the dirty politics, why, I...
Tony, what's the use? This house isn't big enough for both of us.
Wait a minute, Brad. Maybe it is big enough for both of us.
What do you mean?
Well, don't you get it? As you come closer to me, I start to sneeze. But when you stay away beyond a certain distance, it has no effect. Now, the question is to find out just how close we can get together, huh? Oh. Grab that, Brad. Get it, yeah. That's it. Just spread it out there. We'll see how close you and I can. There we are. Now, I'm fine. Good here. Oh, no. Right here. Just the spot right there. It's 10 feet. Brad, if you don't come any closer, we can live here in the house together.
Joni, my tobacco pouch is over there. Do you mind?
Not at all, dear. take it to Brad.
So, back to your mummy. You know, Joni, I have the feeling that, that you're sort of getting a kick out of all this.
Brad, do you want to know how I really feel?
Yeah.
Here's a card for you. Airmail special.
Having a miserable time. Wish you were here.
What is that? It's only 9 feet, and I've got a 10-foot allergy. I'll risk it. Okay, Brad, you can come in now. Can you sleep farther over in the bed, please?
How's this?
Oh, it's no use, Brad. You'll have to get up and sleep in the other room.
I suppose so. Oh.
You know, I wouldn't even mind the sneezing so much. It's just that I'm afraid I'll freeze.
Freeze?
Yeah. Every time I sneeze, I blow the blankets off myself. See what I mean?
Joni, didn't Patton say what it was he wanted to see me about?
No, he didn't. He just said that it was very important and that you should be here by noon. It must be something about the campaign.
Yeah. Well, it's almost...
I'll get it. Oh!
Oh, hi, Brad. Joan.
Hello.
Listen, there's no time to waste. Jim Dooley will be here in a couple of minutes.
Well, who is Jim Dooley?
The TV reporter. He goes into important people's homes and offices and interviews them on the spot.
Now, listen, Brad, here's what happened. Bennington claims that you only came back to Joan for appearance's sake, that it was a political move.
Why?
Naturally, I denied it and offered to prove otherwise. Then Bennington came up with the idea of having Jim Dooley visit you in your home. I had to accept the challenge, so...
Oh, here he is.
Hi, folks. I'm Jimmy Dooley. Right this way, please. Joan? June, put the cards right over here, please, facing the camera.
Well, right here. That's right.
Oh, don't scratch the paint there.
Oh, Judge Bennington came along and brought his wife.
How do you do, Judge Bennington? Mrs. Bennington? May I present my wife, Mrs. Stevens?
Oh, how do you
do? I see you two are back together again.
Yes, and you don't seem to be enjoying it.
Now I know why he takes his wife with him every place he goes. It's better than kissing her goodbye.
Well, Judge and Mrs. Benson, would you please be seated right over here? That's right. Right there. Well, here we are, ready for a look and a listen to some of the people who make the news in our fair city. Brought to you today by yours truly, Jimmy Dooley.
Thank you.
Today, our program comes to you from the home of Judge Bradley J. Stevens, a candidate for Superior Court. Oh, yes, we're also favored with the appearance of his charming wife, Mrs. Stevens. In addition, we have with us Judge Casper T. Bennington, who is Judge Stevens' opponent in the coming election.
Sandwiches, Bennington.
And his most devoted wife, Mrs.
Chop Liver.
Chop Liver. Bennington. Here is Judge Bradley J. Stevens. Judge, please.
Right at the microphone, Judge.
Yes, Judge.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say that, contrary to any of the rumors that you might have heard, my wife and I are as much in love as we were the day we were married.
More! More in love than we ever were before.
And now, folks, let's hear from the woman behind the man, Mrs. Bradley J. Stevens. Mrs. Stevens, up the microphone. Oh, no, please, Judge. I'd like you to stay up here at the microphone, too, please. No, Mrs. Stevens, I'd like you both up the microphone together. Judge, please, you've got to stay up here together. Please, Mrs. Stevens, I have to have you two together here.
They're so much in love, they won't even stand next to each other.
You heard what Judge Bennington said. Now's your chance to deny it. Well, here we are, folks. The inspiration behind the judge's career. Right, Judge Stevens?
I just want to say that Joan and I have been sweethearts since we were in high school. And I think that she is the sweetest, kindest, most beautiful girl in the world. And what's more, I know that she loves me with all her heart.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Casper T. Bennington. You all know me. Now I ask you to look at Judge Stevens' wife. Is that the face of a woman who has ever experienced affection? Love? Tenderness? Is that the happy face of a woman in love? No, ladies and gentlemen, that's an unhappy face. As a matter of fact, it's one of the most miserable faces I've ever seen.
Wait!
Judge Stevens, just a moment. Please.
How could that woman be happy married to a man who places his political ambition above the sanctity of his own home? Ladies and gentlemen, in me you have a candidate who knows that the institution of marriage is the very backbone of our nation. My dear? Go. Just a moment, folks. Now, when you meet my wife, whom I'm about to introduce, you'll see why I'm a happily married man. My dear wife, Matilda. Ladies and gentlemen, here you see in my wife a woman who has joined the marital benefits of a long and faithful companionship. Here you see a woman whose face smiles with love and happiness. What are you trying to do? Make a fool out of me? You wait till I get you home. You just wait, that's all.
Wait for what, you big baboon?
Oh, a baboon, am I? I'm sorry, folks. Just a little family joke between my wife and myself.
Joke, is it? You won't think it's so funny when I break a rolling pin over your thick head.
Well, you fat old bag of bones, you. You're lucky I didn't kick you out of the house years ago.
Bag of bones, am I?
You know, that little incident on Dooley's television show will probably haunt Judge Bennington for the rest of his life.
It's been 3 weeks since it happened, and the town hasn't stopped laughing yet.
Well, he had to withdraw from the election after losing so much face.
Well, he didn't have much face to lose.
But he had it coming to him for spreading that rumor that you and Brad had separated. Say, how does it feel now that you can be close to your husband again?
Oh, just wonderful. You know, it's amazing how quickly I stopped sneezing as soon as I found out what I was allergic to.
I have the only wife in the world who's allergic to her husband's shaving cream.
And I've got the most considerate husband in the world.
Oh, darling.
I'm married, Joan. What a girl, what a world, what a life. Oh, I'm married, Joan. What a mind, love is blind, what a wife. Giddy and gay all day she keeps my heart laughing. Never know where her brain has gone. To each his own. Can't deny that's why I married Joan. To each his own. Can't deny that's why I married Joan.